So for quite a long time I've had this idea that for me the most interesting part of the Gaelic harp traditions is the medieval end of things. I think that the Gaelic harp tradition was in its heyday in the 15th century. You can imagine stages in the life of the Gaelic harp tradition. So if we work backwards, you have the 19th century when it dies out completely with the death of Patrick Byrne and his contemporaries. You have the end of the 18th century when it's dying out and Bunting collects it. You have around the year 1700 or a bit earlier, what happens in the year 1700 or the late 17th century? You have the development of Irish Baroque with Carolan and Lyons and that whole slushy style that we're seeing with Arthur O'Neill playing with the tips of his fingers and chords and all that kind of, that whole 18th century thing we see in the Bunting manuscripts. 1650 to 1700. I mean, if you look back from there, there's a long period of decline all through the 16th and 17th centuries to do with the political scene. And I'm thinking that in the 15th century, the tradition was at its height, when you still have the full extent of old indigenous Gaelic society in Ireland and Scotland, with the retained musicians, the poets, and the harpers. And I don't know how far back you can push that. And I have this sneaky feeling that you might go back, push that back to about 1200, which is when there was big revolutions in syllabic poetry and the formation of the kind of classical
Gaelic order.
Yeah. And so what happened before 1200 or so, I get more and more fuzzy about, partly because there's less and less musical evidence of that. Okay, so I'm thinking of like late medieval, 15th century as a kind of high point in the old Gaelic harp traditions, but this is only a bit impressionistic. And of course, the iconic late 15th century Gaelic musical thing is the Queen Mary harp. Come on, wake up. The Queen Mary harp on the right here in the National Museum of Scotland in Edinburgh. And this is my archaeological copy of the Queen Mary harp, trying to reproduce in as much detail as possible every aspect of the one in the museum in kind of obsessive, nutty archaeological detail. Come in if you want to come to the medieval lecture.
No, it was for Anne.
Anne's upstairs.
Okay.
And so, as well as the Queen Mary harp, there's the Trinity College harp. And Natalie's will do as a stand-in for that. So this is Natalie's copy of the Trinity College harp. Less archaeological than mine, more of a working copy. And you can see them both side by side on the slide here. Now, the Queen Mary harp, people date it to the later 15th century because of the artwork on the forepillar. And the Trinity College harp, we have no idea because nobody's done any study of the artwork.
Yeah, it's based on the dating of the Queen
Mary. It's vaguely the same as the Queen Mary, so it must be the same. But we really don't know. And the first proper study of the Trinity College harp decoration is my poster, which is out on the notice board. You can have a look afterwards. And we can't really date that artwork. And even with the dating of the four-pillar artwork,
we need to have
the rest of the harp is different in style. And so we're starting to think maybe it's even older. Nobody's really suggesting it's older than about 1200, but it fits into that later medieval thing. So I'm thinking of the Queen Mary harp and the Trinity College harp as kind of physical representations of that late medieval musical Gaelic culture. So we have the instruments, and then of course this prompted my question, what's their music? What's the music of these instruments? Okay, and over the years I've got more and more antsy about using them, about treating the tradition as a generic thing, about using Trinity College harp replicas to play early Irish harp music kind of indiscriminately from beginning to end. And so the point of this talk is to try and get to grips with how much can we focus down on that late medieval world. You know yourself that the Bunting manuscripts give us a beautiful, detailed picture of the 18th century end of the tradition. And as you go earlier into the 17th century, there's very few notated pieces of harp music, like the lute books that some of us were working on in class. If you go back to the 16th century, there's nothing written down. There's reverse engineered from 17th century sources. If you go back to the 15th century, no chance. There's nothing, nothing at all. Except
Scott's Lamentation might Scott's be 1599. So
this is why I said it's reverse engineered from later sources, because it's not a 1599 notation and it's not a 1599 performance.
Yeah.
It's an 18th century notation of an 18th century performance that's said to be
so
back.
You have one piece that might
No, but it's
be,
not a piece. Yeah. It's how has it been changed in transmission? Do you see what I mean? There's what I mean by reverse engineered. There's other pieces that there's ways you can get back, but to get back to the end of the. Of the 16th century is hard enough. Siobhan's very excited to have one piece. But I'm interested in over 100 or 150 years earlier than that. Okay. So what? A few was notated in the 17th century.
Yeah.
But this is my mission, is try and get things that point in that direction. So Scott's Lamentation is one. It doesn't point far enough, but it points there. And there are other things pointing. So this is our mission, to think of things that can point in that direction. So I don't know how much time we'll have to do playing things or how much time we'll be able to spend on anything else or whether we'll even get through them. I want to get through them all, so we're going to rush. So the first thing to look at, and this is very brief, does everyone have this handout, which I gave in my previous lectures?
No,
do
you
not
have
it?
I don't have it. Oh,
so anyone who does, anyone who didn't come to my previous lecture, you have two there.
No, I didn't.
You didn't have it. I thought you did.
Yes, I'll give you another one.
If nobody else needs it.
It's just a copy of what's on the screen. And this this is the medieval garage, which I talked at great length about in my... When was my last talk? Was it Friday?
Possibly.
Yeah. So we talked about the medieval gamut. We discussed how it worked, how you have the range of notes from G at the bottom of the bass clef all the way up. G, A, B natural, C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat and B natural, middle C... D, E, F, G, A, B flat, B natural, C, D, E, and there's the top of your range. Okay, so this defines for us the musical space which we imagine we might be working in, although this is continental evidence, it's not totally definitive, it's not specifically Gaelic, but it points us in a direction. This is what people were doing, this is how people were conceptualising the musical world in 15th century Netherlands. Okay, so at the same time, but over the sea. And the most important thing for me about this is that the shifting note in the scale is B. That you turn B up to B natural or you turn it down to B flat. And this is the basis of my suggested medieval Gaelic harp tuning regime, which I talked about on Friday. So I imagine that our harp should have B natural and B flat as a shifting note on them. And this implies that I... Unison drones, Nicoli is at middle C. And if anyone wants to do any playing in this talk, all these harps on the floor have Nicoli at middle C.
And on that one too.
Yes, Karen's pointing at her harp, which is a copy of the Lamont harp, and I didn't put the Lamont harp on the slide because I'm not sure if it's medieval or not. It might be, or it might be later in its current form incorporating medieval components. So I'm being very naughty and completely ignoring that side of things.
It has
a date inside
mind. The sound box.
It has a date inside, I know it does. But in its current form, I don't know. If it's dated and it proves to be medieval, then it has implications for understanding this.
Well, yes, we'll have to talk about this later during the tea break. But
yes, so the Lamont harp is the first. There's going to be lots of these. There's going to be lots of elephants coming barging and saying, "Look at me, look at me." And the Lamont harp is the first one. And that's why I left it there rather than hiding it away in its case. Okay, so it's sitting there looking at you all going, "Yeah, but what about me? Hello?" So I don't know about the Lamont harp. It works slightly differently. It doesn't work. Trinity College and Queen Mary harp work the same. The Lamont harp works differently, and so this is an issue.
Well, yeah, I think they're not from the same centuries.
Okay. Good. Okay, related to the gamut is plain chant, because the gamut is designed for plain chant, and by plain chant I mean monastic, religious, unaccompanied song.
How do you know it's unaccompanied?
I don't. That's what I mean by it. But I'm very slack.
No,
so
I just thought. So sorry, I'll just that came out of my mouth without.
No, quite right.
I mean,
do we know it's unaccompanied? We don't. It's unaccompanied, and there's a single melody line. That's what I meant by unaccompanied.
Yeah,
it's always presented as a single melody line.
Yeah.
You mean by plain chant? Although actually, by the late medieval times, you get polyphony, and you get polyphony in Ireland early.
Yeah.
As
in the
well.
12th century.
Yeah.
Already.
So we have polyphonic monastic religious singing as well as unaccompanied. So.
Yeah.
You see, it gets more and more difficult, but I'm trying to rattle through it. So here's a little example of plain chant that I thought you might like to have a look at. I should say that the provenance of the Queen Mary harp as well, it has this connection to Iona or to the west of Scotland. And so this Iona being the centre of the place where St. Columba founded his monastery. And so this is a chant for St. Columba. So I just thought, well, that kind of ties in. You might have to do one between two. I'm not sure how many we've got.
There's
more people here than.
Right.
Okay. One between two. I'll always come back later. Maybe even one between more than two. I've got two left. Who else wants one?
Are we going to sing it?
Yes, why not?
Shall I sing it to them so they hear it?
Yes, do you want to
sing
it?
Salve splendoret patrone, iubarque justitiae, orthodoxe doctor, bone pastor et vas gratiae. O Columba, Columbi, Felis memoriae, tue fac nos sine fine, coedes gloriae.
Gives you
an idea.
Yeah.
Oh, lovely.
So those of you who have been practicing your sight singing should be able to vaguely sing along with this, following the dots. Are there any big issues with the notation?
Yeah, it changes clefs all over the place.
Where does the change? Where does the clef change? I think there's only one or two.
Yeah. It's in the fine line.
Yeah, so here's a clef change.
Before memoriae.
This.
After Felicis and before Memoriae, I think.
Yeah. So this section here is
and after Nos,
yeah.
Before
so
Sine.
Fac Nos, here's the clef change. Sine. So this section, Memoriae to a Fac Nos. You've got the words written on your hand there, haven't you, in clef sets?
Yeah, two clef changes.
So be aware of that. So let's try it, just see what happens.
How do you approach the bits that look like double stops?
Sorry?
Oh, the two notes? You
yes.
sing, if they're two vertically aligned, you sing
go
the bottom one first. You sing
you
the bottom one first.
Oh.
They just fold it back on itself to save space.
Salve, should we take that sort of pitch?
Yeah, okay.
Salve splendor. Et patron. We're now on the second system. Iubarque justitiae. Sorry. Orthodoxe doctore, bone pastor et vas. We got our syllables wrong, sorry.
O Columba, Columbi, Felicis memoriae, tue fac nos sine fine, coedes gloriae. Okay. Now, you could just play this on the harp. You could sing it. You could use it as an idea of a medieval style of music that's out there at this time. in the same kind of cultural milieu that the harp is playing at. So I think that's what I want to do here, is rattle through stuff and file it away in our brain. This is what was happening at that time. We know this was happening at the time because they wrote it down. This is a 14th century manuscript from Scotland, from a St. Columba monastery. It's not from Iona, but from another St. Columba monastery. And so, and the harp has that Iona connection, 15th century or earlier Iona connection. So this is right there. This is the music that was at the time that we're interested in when the harps were there. Yes, does that make sense? We could have an entire hour lecture just on that tune and teasing out these connections, but we don't have time. Okay. And there's a thing about plain chant that I'm quite interested in it, that there's this craftsmanship of the unaccompanied diatonic melody. The melody that just goes up and down within a single mode, and there is no harmony. That each note sings pure and clean, and that the melody defines a shape, and that I've come across this idea that there's this real subtle aesthetic craftsmanship of that musical form that was very strong in medieval times. So this is interesting to me as a concept. Okay. Another piece of evidence, Jane mentioned Robert Ab Hughes. So there's this whole Welsh tradition. Okay, so we're still not in the Gaelic world yet, but we're getting closer. So in Welsh tradition, they have a repertory of music that was notated in the 17th century, and there's also a body of historical and mythological lore associated with that musical traditions. And the historical and mythological lore states fairly boldly that this medieval Welsh music originated in Ireland. So one between two, if you please. And if there's more, this is a very rough paraphrase translation. This is a very rough paraphrase translation, and this is the complete text. It's very short.
We've got it in French.
Well, that's very good for you.
Stéphane, tu as français ou anglais? Anglais. Okay, tu veux avoir quelqu'un en français?
Swap then.
Oh, I also have it in French.
Swap with Sylvia.
Like a French one. I don't mind.
I wonder why I had more of this one.
Like a
especially
one.
For you, Stefan. I bought my French version, which is rubbish French, but never mind. So this is a very rough translation, paraphrase translation. And this is the beginning of it. So it starts. The book called Cadwedigath Cirth Dan, The Preservation of String Music, and it starts. The preservation of string music. I.e. harps, crwths, a kind of fiddle. So harps and crwths in the four bardic provinces of Wales. Okay, and this is how the treatise opens. And then the treatise finishes at the bottom here. So it's very tiny. I mean, it's just like three or four pages of this manuscript. And it explains this myth. This version, please. It's too hard to translate.
And so it
explains that there was a meeting at Glendalough, and here's a picture of Glendalough for you at the bottom with the round tower. Okay, and the meeting was called by Murdoch of Brian, who was the king of Munster, and he was the High King of Ireland, and he's the grandson of Brian Boru. So he called a meeting at Glendalough of all the master musicians, and there was a doctor of music whose name we're not told, who was the chair, and then there were these sort of official representatives, and they seem to be representatives of the different nations. So we have Alan ap Cynan, and he would be a Welsh prince. Cuthbert the Bald, he's a Scottish king from the south west of Scotland, sort of north of Carlisle area. Matholwch the Irishman, and Matholwch is a mythical Irish king from early medieval times, so he wasn't even alive at the time of the meeting, but he was there as the Irish representative. And Olaf, the musician, well, Olaf, this might be the Viking king of Dublin, who again wasn't around at that time, but never mind, this is mythological history. So you have representatives from Wales, Scotland, Ireland, and the Vikings. And listening, so auditing but not participating, was Henry Redback, so presumably this is one of the kings of England, King Henry of England.
Oh, right.
And Carsey the harper. Carsey is the local saint at Glendalough. So the English get to sit in and listen, and Glendalough itself. Carsey was Kevin's teacher.
Oh, I see. I never heard of him.
Sorry,
okay.
Where is Glendalough? I guess you know.
In the Wicklow Mountains, just
south
of Dublin.
Of Dublin, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so they had this meeting, okay, right at the year 1100. And they set down 24 measures, sort of a 24-fold system of conceptualising the music. And it says to compose music, to recognise it, to memorise it. So a system for kind of oral transmission and composition of music. Using Irish, of course, because that was their native language. And Murdoch O'Brien sort of stamped his seal and said, let it be so, let no one mix these 24 up, let them be fixed. Okay. And then all the manuscript editions are different because they mix them up like mad, because that's the way these things work. And on the back, you've got the 24 measures, but we're not going to talk about these today. So this is the origins of this Welsh tradition. This is fascinating because they wrote down so much. Okay, so this is a way in. We can't take it at face value because it's mythical history, because it's very Welsh, but it gives us a sniff of the kind of things that people were thinking about at that time. Okay. So we have these mythical Irish origins of it. The structure of the music that's notated is very geometric. It's not tunes. It's not melodies like you see in Bunting's manuscript. It's not even melodies like plain chant. It's like geometric patterns, like knitting machine patterns almost. It's very, very different from the kind of stuff that we would see later. And some of the scholars... This stuff is massively understudied. There are scholars working at it, and they're all a bit eccentric and independent, and they don't necessarily agree with each other, and they don't tend to do sensible things like making critical editions of the sources. What they tend to do is read the facsimiles and explain their comprehensive and detailed theories as to how it originally was, without much of a... get much connection between the theory and the source. So there's a massive lack of proper scholarly study, creation of critical sources and commentary on them. So there's very little you can say about this stuff sensibly. There was a Finnish PhD by Pekka Toivonen, which was very interesting from a kind of ethnomusicological point of view, trying to understand the structural way that the music works as an oral tradition music, and the idea that you have this selection of little tags in your head that you combine together in an improvisatory way to create huge structured geometrical performances or compositions. So I'm very interested in this idea of geometrical music formed from technical fragments, not fragments of music, but fragments of concepts, like finger gestures, like patterns of dissonance and consonance that you build together in like architecture to create the geometrical musical composition. Okay, so there's that. Perhaps we should play an example. Grab a harp. Grab a harp if you want to. Nobody wants to play. Nobody wants to play. No? Okay, in that case we won't play. No, go on, one person wants to play. Grab a harp. Grab a harp, grab any harp. Nobody else? So you might, for example, find Nicoli on middle C. And Cronan on C below. So you might play that as a consonant chord. Yeah, then you might play a dissonant chord by moving one note in. Natural, which is less than idea, but never mind. And then you might play a consonant chord by moving back out to get to C.
We could try A, A, B, G, that would be the minor. Try A, A octave and move in.
Okay, move down now, play A. You can't, because we haven't got B,
no,
we haven't got B in the bass.
Okay, up a bit higher or something.
Bass pattern.
Oh, you want a bass pattern.
Yeah.
What have you got?
Well, what's wrong with CB?
Well, why don't you try...
What's wrong with CB?
Well, you were complaining.
No, I wasn't really complaining. Okay, so...
You try and help them.
So have a look at the back side of your sheet. The first sequence is the simplest sequence. Zero means your dissonant chord, and one means your consonant chord. Okay? So we want to play dissonant, dissonant, consonant, consonant. Dissonant, dissonant, consonant, consonant. So let's play the C chord. Sorry, dissonant. Do we want the D B chord? And then we're coming in one note to D and B as a sixth. Does that make sense? Okay. So let's play it. And our sequence is called Titter the Bach. And so we're going to play just the bass of that. It's very simple and geometric. Okay. And we're going to start on the away chords, the dissonant chord. Off we go. Elaborate chords than this, but simple is good for a starter. And then choose an ornament or a gesture for your left hand. Okay, so we want to. It's like that. Is that good? Okay. Yeah. So some kind of flick down onto C, onto top C. Okay. And then you can play that at the same time as each chord. But we have to do our patterns. You have to do the dissonant one first. It's going to be foully dissonant. Okay, ready? Sorry. C, B and D. Does that make sense? Shall we try it again? Okay, ready and. Questions? Does this make sense? Do you see where we're going with this? We're creating a geometric. I was going to say quite sophisticated.
You can play computer
programs. It's simple. It's a simple example of this music because we're using the simplest measure, we're using the simplest chord, and we're using the simplest sequence of gestures. But you can see how this could get massively elaborate if you have a three-note chord and you have a sequence of three or four different gestures for each chord note. Yeah. So that's how that works. Is everyone happy with that? Okay, a lot of scholars have pointed out that there's another geometrical musical tradition that's got significant relationships with this Welsh Cerdd dance tradition, and that is the Pibroch or Ceolmore tradition in Scotland. Now, this was first notated quite late. It was first notated about the same time that Bunting was working, or a little bit earlier, in the 1780s, I would say. But it's an oral tradition, just like the harp, just like the 18th century harps. It's an oral tradition that goes back a lot further than that. One of the problems with the Ceolmore tradition is that we don't have very much earlier, whereas we do have more information earlier about the harper, so it's less clear how old this tradition goes, how far back it goes. But there's another big difference between what Bunting was notating from the harpers and what these pipers were notating from the Ceolmore tradition, and that is Bunting was writing from the harpers mostly up-to-date 18th century music that's recognisably related to Baroque music on the continent. Cornelius de Lion's divisions, Carolina's Italianate music, it's very up-to-date, the harp music. This stuff is not. This is completely different from the mainstream of continental music. Its real nearest relative is the medieval Welsh music that we see in Robert Ap Hugh and those Welsh treatises. It's a much older, much less connected, much more indigenous musical form. This is not the earliest notation. This is an 1820 printed piano arrangement of this music, where he set it with bass chords for the piano. But he's also written in all the little distinctive piping twiddles. So that actually, if you're a piper, you can play this on the big pipes completely. Or if you're a pianist, you can play it on the piano. I should do what Anne did and get a historical pianist to rattle through this stuff, shouldn't I?
Yeah, it'd be fun.
It's good fun. And the bass is very interesting for 1820, they're incredibly old-fashioned. So he's desperately struggling to make the piano sound a bit like the pipes, but also to try and get some harmonic sense out of the way the music works, which is non-harmonic music. So this is an incredibly rich tradition, and it's a living tradition still, unlike what we've looked at before, which is basically a dead tradition that's kind of been revived. Because, is it fair to say, plain chant kind of died out and was revived from books? And Robert Ap Hugh music died out and is only just now being revived by scholars. Whereas this tradition is still alive. Okay? It's changed massively. It changed massively in the 20th century and became hyper-literate. So that nowadays, although they talk about oral learning, you basically have to play what's in the book down to the exact grace notes. But we have this range of early 19th century sources. We have a huge amount of tradition, but in the living oral tradition, there's a lot of very interesting information related to it. One of the things that I find really fascinating is that there are songs associated with these tunes. Now, these songs are not really in the oral tradition anymore. They died out generations ago, so the only people really singing the songs that go with these big geometric instrumental tunes are scholars who are reviving them, like Alan MacDonald. But there were singers in the oral tradition who had these songs up into the 50s and 60s, and so they were recorded on tape recorder. Okay. So, if all the machinery works, we'll have a go at listening to one, and then if you're feeling very brave, we can sing it. So, can you hand these out, thank you, while I get the machine working?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably one between two.
Thank you.
Okay, so what I've given you, this is a tune that I choose to work. There's a big range of tunes in this Kilmore tradition. There's a few hundred tunes in the repertoire. The tunes on average are about 10 minutes long. They're big, big geometrical music. And there's a number of them that have traditional associations with late medieval times. And so this is an example. This is Pibre Conal Hu, so the piping music of Black Donald, Balach of the Isles, his march to the first battle at Inverlochy in 1427. And you think, well, how cool. Does that mean this tune just goes back to 1427? And of course, the quick answer is, of course it doesn't. This is an 1820 piano arrangement, you know? But what's the connection? When did this tune come into being as a commemoration of this battle in 1427? And so I like to think, perhaps, give it the benefit of the doubt, think it might be very old, what can we draw out of it, all the while being aware that it's an 1820 piano score that we're listening to, okay? So I've given you the handouts of the words. And I don't have a copy, but
oh,
mind.
Fine.
What does it say on them? At the bottom are web links to this audio recording I'm going to play you. So we're going to listen to Alistair Boyd. Oh dear, I don't know what year this is recorded in. I'm guessing it's the 1950s or 60s. But you can go to that website and you can listen to him, and you can also search on that website and get probably 20 different variant versions of this song with different words and different tunes, but all related to each other. Okay?
Hebrew, Hebrew, Hebrew. brach hol dui hi brach hol hi alles brach du es hai in our loch hai du hai du hai du hi do hi do
feel, it's got a different kind of structure. I think this is a much later interpolation. Thinking now that this is a, well, you see, then this is different. This is very lyrical. There are other versions that I don't have recordings of, which are different in form. So if you look at the tune, you can see the tune of the instrumental. Yan da dum ba dum, yan da dum tia dum, yan da dum tan tia, yan da dum tia dum. And these are the geometric fragments which are then assembled together. It carries on. Yan da dum tan tia, yan da dum tia dum, yan da dum tan tia, yan da dum tia dum. Yan tilian daram, yan tilian daram, yan tilian dan trian, yan tilian daram, yan tilian dan tria, yan tilian dan tra, yan tilian dan tria, yan tilian daram. So this is those motifs just mixed and matched in very subtly consonant and dissonant versions, as to whether it has a third, hails the third at the end or the second of the drone. Okay, so there are sung versions that are much more up and atom. And so on like that. But our man Alistair Boyd has this very lyrical version. And at first I thought, oh, Alistair's is the most beautiful, it's what I want to study. And then I thought, yeah, but it's very lyrical, does that mean it's very late? Yeah. And that the geometric version is earlier. And then I thought, why do I think that? how can you tell which of those is older and which one of them is more modern? Is the simpler one more modern because it's influenced by the instrumental setting? Or is the more lyrical one more modern because it's influenced by 18th century musical aesthetics? How can you tell? I don't know. But file it away in the back of your mind and see what happens. It's all interesting and relevant. Okay? So this Kyolmore tradition, for me, is one of the vital ways in to this music that we're searching for. It's so rich, and it's so complex, and it has such deep roots, and there's so much of it that on the surface claims to be with 15th century origins. There's plenty of it that's later, that's by named composers in the 16th and 17th centuries, but there's quite a lot of it that has this traditional association back. And a lot of the traditional ones that go back are connected to the Lords of the Isles, who were the kings of the west of Scotland, almost independent from the Scottish crown in Edinburgh. And they were the people who had Iona as their cathedral, and under whose patronage the Queen Mary harp may well have been decorated or assembled in its final form. So they're people who are interested, and their dominions covered the west of Scotland and the north of Ulster. So they're in between Scotland and Ireland, and they're almost like a heartland of the old Gaelic world. So they're really important as a cultural area that we have to pay attention to. And so this music that connects itself back traditionally to their world, I think, is very, very important. Very complex, very subtle. And there's people who spend a lifetime studying this stuff and don't even scratch the surface. So it's a huge resource for us to look at to try and understand the medieval Gaelic harp traditions. Okay, we have bardic poetry. So this is just a fragment of a 13th century poem that specifically mentions stringed instruments. So I thought I'd put this up here as a cipher. This is not an area that I'm particularly specialist in, but I try and be aware of it. So there's a huge body of medieval poetry from Ireland and from Scotland. They would say there's probably, well, people say there's more of Ireland, but actually the scholars have said the language and the structure of this poetry is so high and classical, like international Latin, that you can't really use the language to tell which end of the old Gaelic world it's from. It's only when it refers to named individuals that the poetry is written for that you can localise it, and often that you can even date it. Karen?
Simon, I think the word for cor means curve, but it also means the neck of the harp. So that could...
Yes, but some people call the neck of the harp the curve. So I'm being deliberately ambiguous with my word. But yes,
the
curve of the harp, maybe.
It's clown, like clown in Irish. It's like the clean neck of the harp. And cur clown rae hula.
Yes.
I don't know if this clown is the same as clown in Irish.
Yes.
Like
I've deliberately tweaked the translation because it's so poetical. Every word has multiple layers of meaning. So I've deliberately tweaked the translation to be as bland as possible so as not to overload it or to lead in one way or the other. You see, I put the word from behind the harp, but actually it's archul and chran slavrachy, which is behind. Chran is the branch. And the slavra is the chain that hangs down from the chimney to support the cooking pots. So how do you translate that? You know, it's the kind of the branch that's somehow associated with chains or metally loopy things. You know, it's obviously it's a kind of elaborate poetical description of the harp with all this metalwork through it, I think. But I think that's what the scholars seem to take it as. Anyway, so we have this body of poetry. Most of the scholars say, oh yes, the poetry survives in books, but it wasn't originally written as a written form, it's a spoken or sung, it's a sung art form basically, it would have been sung. And then you can argue like mad about what do you mean by singing, what kind of singing? You know, do you mean singing or chanting? And this is a big issue. The other thing about it is that it's not rhythmical poetry, it's syllabic poetry. So instead of counting the number of stresses in a bar, one, da, two, da, one, da, two, da, three, one, da, two, da, three, da, four, one, da, two, it doesn't work like that. You count the number of syllables. Is it six syllables alone?
Six, seven.
Something like that. And obviously language changes makes it, and corruption means it's hard to get the... And there's all kinds of internal rhymes and internal alliteration as part of that syllable counting. But that means that the actual stressed syllables are kind of, they're not relevant to the scheme. So you have random placement of stresses and random numbers of stresses on each line. So this pattern of stresses when you speak it is not structured at all. The structure is totally in the syllables and in the alliteration and in the internal rhyme. So it's freaky stuff. And yet it's meant to have been sung with harp accompaniment. This is what the scholars in the old text suggest. So this is a big problem in medieval performance practice studies, how on earth do you get this stuff working? And various people have tried with limited success, because how do you judge whether an attempt is good or not? Because it's so different from anything that we know about. It's really hard to judge it on any merits, because sure, it's going to sound freaky and weird. And how do you tell if it's freaky or weird bad, or freaky and weird the right thing? But it's an important thing, and the body of poetry is filled with imagery and cultural atmosphere and information, so we have to pay attention to it. Okay. Image. Next area of study is fascinatingly important because it connects to this, and that is there's a body of syllabic poetry with medieval roots that survives in the oral tradition. And you can listen online. So what this deal is that there's a body of poetry which is basically epic ballads in Gaelic. Some of them are pretty close matches for 12th, 13th century text versions that we have. Some of them are clearly later in the style. And they... as a body, they were sung up into the 20th century. I think they died out in Ireland earlier. I'm only aware of a few field recordings of Irish singers, and they're not very easy to listen to because they've almost turned into just chatting. But in Scotland, the tradition was quite thriving all the way through the 50s, 60s. I think the last tradition bearers were probably dying in the 70s. There's one of these ballads that was passed down. It's a ballad connected to the King Arthur cycle, and there are three people from South Uist who still have it in their to each other. So one passed it to the other. One of them's an old lady, and she passed it to a middle-aged lady, and the middle-aged lady passed it to a girl in her who's in her 20s now. But she's a professional singer, and so her style is quite different from the old lady. So I wonder if that's that one passing out of old tradition, yeah.
Is it in the classical language or is it more modern?
Kind of halfway in between. They've kind of become modernised, but you can't modernise them too much, or you lose the poetical structure. So they include classical words that the singers don't really understand,
mm-hmm.
and some of the words have been changed, which breaks the meter and the structure. And so I was very lucky. I went to an event in Edinburgh some years ago where the professor who studies this stuff invited the two older ladies to come and present. And so he played an archive recording from the 1950s, and then the older lady sang, and then the younger lady sang. So you had three generations. It's very exciting. But this one I've chosen to show you. We've got the full text, translation, and gobbledygook phonetics. So if you read the phonetics as if it was written in English phonetics, then you'll get approximately the right kind of sounds. this is a system that I learned from a Gaelic singer, Wilma Kennedy in Dundee, and I thought, if it's good enough for her, it's good enough for me, we can manage. So you kind of rattle through and you approximately get the right sounds. And so we can listen to Kate MacDonald singing this. And the structure of it is so interesting. She rattles through these lines. You can hear the syllable count changing with each line. You can hear she's fitting the melody onto the changing rhythmical structure of each line. She repeats each pair of lines as the beginning and end. And I think this is to do with the storytelling aspect. You're saying the lines, and then you sing them again, and this gives you a second chance to follow what the story's doing. Okay? Of this song. Some of them have a few more extra verses. One of them explains that that the woman comes and finds him bleeding on the little hillock and takes him home and looks after him and reveals that actually she's the king's daughter and he saved her from the ogre and they get married and live happily ever after. And so there's all kinds of backstory to this stuff. And so this is one of the things that fascinates me to get married songs is how incredibly terse they are, so stripped down. And the lack of emotion, when she gets to the bit that he meets the giant, and the giant throws a spear, and the giant's five heads off. This is the first time you know the giant has five heads. And it's just so deadpan. And I love that, that real compact way. And I think that's because you're meant to know the story, but it reminds me of that understated geometrical structure that you see in the instrumental music in the Kyawamore tradition. Do you see what I mean? It's that it repeats, it goes round and round and round. It tries not to too much. And the drama comes from outrageous things happening while you're pretending that they're not, I think. And there's a lot of this stuff. I'm thinking that there might be 10 different ballads. and there might be 30 or 40 different field recordings of variants of them by different singers with different tunes, and it's a fascinating resource to look at this stuff. And so of course you can ask a question like, how old is this performance practice? How much? Obviously it's old, because some of the texts you can trace back to 12th century originals in versions of. How much have they changed since then? You can do linguistic stuff and see how much the text has changed. You can see new words coming in, you can see old words becoming obsolete and becoming corrupted. What about the singing style though? Different singers have different styles. This is one of the things you can do, compare different ballads. Some people are quite free with their rhythm, some people try and compress it down, some people sing some stressed language syllables on stressed musical notes, and you have like this kind of wrench stress, it's called, where the whole thing gets kind of topsy-turvy. Some of these ballads have shifted into the work song tradition and are sung for the very rhythmical work songs to go along with the, you know, that kind of very solid rhythm, and a song like that would be is compressed into that kind of structure. So there's all kinds of things going on with this medieval derived song tradition, which I think is just fascinating. So my final thought really is that what we're trying to do is we're trying to pick up not just on technical things, but on a whole aesthetic world. We're interested in a medieval aesthetic, because I think just as when we're looking at Bunting's manuscripts, when we're looking at the later sources, we try and get this aesthetic to say, what do we think is the real thing? You know, who put this chord in? Was this put in by Arthur O'Neill, or was it put in by Edward Bunting? We try and put this to make that decision as to where we think this influence comes from. So we can do the same kind of work here. It's just much, much more difficult. But I think I think it's necessary to try and get what the medieval aesthetic. And so this is the shrine of St. Patrick's Bell, which I guess is in the National Museum in Kildare. And so I'm just fascinated by the geometric. It's like simultaneously understated and over the top. But do you understand what I mean by understated? It's so minuscule. Whatever scale you look at it, there's things happening. If you zoom right in on a tiny little fragment, there's all kinds of stuff going on, and it scales out. It's like almost like a fractal kind of idea that there's stuff going on. Nothing is left plain. Everything's covered in intricate detail, but the intricate detail expands to reveal a huge underlying structure, and that huge underlying structure is really important. And there's middle levels of structure as well. So I'm interested that the aesthetic seems to be a structural aesthetic rather than a kind of lyrical, organic aesthetic. This is the kind of impression that I'm getting. But you need to look at it more. You need to kind of immerse yourself in this kind of thing. And then it's from this point of view that you might start reading texts like, I haven't mentioned Gerald of Wales, because of course he is an important source. But he's very hard to read because he's so obscure. But perhaps if we go away and read Gerald of Wales now, after looking at all this other stuff, we might have new ideas. What is he talking about? That'll do.
Wow.
Wow. Any questions for in the last minute?
Going back to the kind of key block,
yes,
song stuff, because I know you talked, yes, but I was just thinking about that fourth verse that you give in the,
yes,
key block of John B. What kind of evidence is there that some of these corrupted verses might be based around, you know, as you have with stuff like Urinor, for example, the kind of beginnings of a divergence between song tradition, pibroch tradition?
I don't know. It's so hard to pin anything down. We're working on overall impressions at the moment, and so I can't really say more than my impression is that final verse doesn't really fit.
Why do you think it doesn't fit? What is it?
Because it kind of expands out. The previous verses are very repetitive, and that final verse.
But it's reasonable because you have the car of Cochrane, car of Pube, and car of. There's three repetitions, but then you're right, it's not all of the others are all
Utterly mindlessly repetitive.
Well, going back to the kind of cantrip principle where your vowels are your notes and your consonants are your graces, there is a degree of consonance between Kharov and Kharov.
Okay. Yeah.
For example.
Okay, so at this stage nothing is fixed, nothing is certain. This is only the beginnings of an attempt to assemble this stuff all together. So I'm just throwing out first impressions, but I don't want to rule anything out, but neither do I want to insist this is the way it is. So it's a good point that maybe a song, maybe a verse like that is a sudden dramatic shift that is very old. Maura?
I just wanted to mention at Eamon when he was doing the Gaelic song tradition.
Yes.
Did mention that there's a living tradition all the way of syllabic poetry.
Yes.
In the living tradition of song singing, they're singing syllabic poetry.
Okay, so that's sort of other syllabic poems in Irish.
There's syllabic poetry
okay.
in the continuing live tradition.
Right, okay.
Most of it's gone, but there are some.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that, so that's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You showed us a few of those.
Good. Well, I need to... The other thing about this is that there's lots of stuff that I haven't come across yet and that we haven't connected in yet, so I'm sure there's much more to find than this. This is just a rattling overview of what I've managed to find so far. After only a few years of digging at this.
Just one more thought about this, you know, where it sort of changes towards the end. It reminds me a bit of Cú Chathaoirneasán, this long
very good.
Sort of 17th, 18th century song where the pulse in the meter in the poetry increases as you... It appears to increase as you go through.
But that increasing pulse is very common in Kilmore.
Yeah, so as you get to the end, you're just spitting out all these adjectives. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah.
And
very
so
good.
The whole... So you look at all these
very
verses
good.
And you think, oh, this is going to be just really long and uninteresting, but actually the pulse is increasing all the time,
good.
So it's very interesting. I'm just wondering if there's a tiny little hint
to
that.
Good.
It just reminded me, maybe not relevant at all.
We have to look at this stuff so closely and so carefully and so long to get it. And to return right back to the beginning, what I said on Friday, if our aim is to get the medieval harps up and running and to get their repertory, we also have to have them set up right. And so this is the whole thing of get the harp set up right with B flat and B natural, and if we think that's plausible, set up right. We argue for what we do, but we could, but we can't. We shouldn't just assume that as received is going to work.
Another thing is just historically speaking, 15th century is actually the early modern period. It's not medieval. nowadays, the historians would just go
in,
kind
from a West of Scotland point of view, there's a massive break around 1500 when the Lordship of the Isles comes. From a West of Scotland, historians would say that's the end of medieval.
But medieval is different everywhere. I mean, we had Scandinavians who were talking about medieval right up until the 16th century. We just have to remember that what was happening. I mean, we had the Normans come in. And with all their influences, and you know, there's and 15th century is early modern in Ireland, at least historically speaking.
Sure.
So there's other things coming in at the same time.
Yes.
And those Normans seem to, again, going back to Eamon, he's talking about the lyric poetry of the lyric, if that's the right thing, the love songs of in the French tradition that seem to have very much influenced the poet.
Yes.
Poetics in Ireland and may also have influenced music. So there's all these things going on as well that you have to be careful about.
That's right, all the international connections. Oh no, it was all tied into the international scene, definitely.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's a long period of time that we're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, hundreds of years. Was there change in that time? Was it conservative and fixed, or was it changing? And when were the changes? And it's all up in the air.
There's a conference next month actually on the love poetry tradition.
On which the?
On Dolte Grada.
Where is that?
In Trinity, I think. Part of Dublin Institute of Advanced Studies.
Wow.
That'll do, I think. Tea break time.
Thanks,
Simon. Is it practice time?
I know, we keep telling... Why
okay.
do we keep telling him it's tea
because
break?
Because it's staff tea break time.
Staff tea break time.
Yes, off you go in practice.
It's back to the minds for the students.